Now let's see a great example of how to govern technology in the digital world with a working microservices architecture. Please welcome solution architect of Hermes, being responsible for the development of the EAM platform, and he's matching the event color of today and tomorrow. Please welcome Thorsten Dübelmeier.
Thanks a lot for the nice introduction and welcome to the last talk for today. So just after that, we're starting with the drinks and with the food. What I like to present to you is our journey for Lean EIM and regarding mostly to the aspect of integration of our EIM landscape, that we're not just in the middle of a tool, but we have a tool landscape around, and what we did for the various landscapes and use cases. So let's come to the agenda. I want to present some words to the Hermes group, because perhaps some of you don't know Hermes. Then I want to say some words to our challenge, why we started this initiative. For that, we did a survey for the whole IT, where we got some ideas where the main topics or pain points are. Then there are three agenda topics for the integration overall for developers: what is the microservice part, process modeler regarding Signavio, and occasional user, it's mainly Confluence. And after that, some words how we did it and what are perhaps your takeaways and lessons learned. So, just to say some words to my side, I'm born near Siegburg. I came to Hamburg in 2001. I have two kids that are in school right now and started with coding in an insurance company. It was this 99% known jobs we had in the keynote today morning. And now went from programming to solution architect job. So, Hermes Group. Probably you know the Hermes from the parcels. When you get the parcels to your home, you shopped at Amazon or Otto or whatever, Zalando. But we are quite more than only parcel delivery. We have the so-called Hermes Einrichtung Service. We are bringing all the big ones, furniture and all the stuff for the kitchen. But we also have international supply chain solutions and consulting as Vordagoo, that's something, a startup, a small company we have. And we have third part, also sourcing for products. That's mainly the Hanse control. When the companies get goods from China or whatever, here they have to be checked, and that's all done by a Hanse control. So, some more figures around the globe. We have about 15,000 employees. We have 1,500 of these little vehicles that are bringing the parcels, 76 million shipments. And we are then the number one in transporting furniture, also because of Otto is number one in selling furniture on the internet, not IKEA, what you might thinking, but it's Otto at the moment. And number two in the B2C parcel delivery, of course, the number one was much, much bigger is DHL, some meters from here. Okay, what we done? So also we have European parcels, or what are our clients? It's mainly Otto, because we are belonging to the Otto group right now, so we are the main and doing the most parcels of the Otto group, but it's only a part. We're doing 80% also for other clients. That's one of the biggest is Amazon, or is Zalando, or H&M. And the last for Hermes, we have approximately 14,000 delivery drivers. As I know, it's about 3,000 more now for the Christmas business that we hired to deliver all the parcels in the Christmas bills. And we have 35 parcel drop-off points across Europe. So, that's enough for Hermes. So what is our challenge, mainly not directly only in EIM, but in our IT? So, we are quite special business. There's no standard software for delivering parcels and all these specific use cases. So there's no SAP for parcel delivery companies. So what we do, we have a lot of in-house development. Of course, we have for CRM, for HR, and all these topics, we have standard softwares. But all our operational softwares are mainly developed in-house and developed by our own. We have not these big, huge systems like SAP, but mainly, or not so, the small systems is mainly medium, and it's from the past, the main, or the backbone for production is an AS400 and an own developed Java system. But what we want to do, like, of course, most of you, is bringing this big legacy system to smaller parts, so to have more and more microservice architecture. And because of market changes and that we have not making so much money with partners, we have the struggle from the market. So what we have very, very lot of changes in parallel. So there's not one project exchanging one system or developing neu, but there are a lot of in parallel. So it's when you start a project, you cannot be sure when you, well, for example, have 1 year project, you don't be sure what application landscape will be when you are in production. So what we also have, also driven from the past, we say in German, historisch gewachsen, because there are a lot of systems that are very much interwoven, because there's not, we don't have, what we heard for business capabilities or some other reasons, special systems, but they are exchanging a lot of data and they're very closed couples with many interfaces. So what we also, with microservice, want to address, to have more vertical integration and to have more and more services that are used. So we don't have a point-to-point integration, for example, for master data, they're giving it to application A, B, and C, and D, but a service where to get master data. So to conclude it, technology is the way or the key for us for improvement. So logistics is the parcel when it's get from Amazon or whatever from a private customer to a target, there is a physical minimum of stuff. So we have, you can't go more and more, as you can't optimize this by the end. So there is what we here see is something like 30 hours. There has to be for the transportation, so we can't optimize it to the end. So the customer is also. It's changing because specifically in German we have the requirement that the parcel has to be there next day. Perhaps we're at the same day and all the clients expect to have it. So it's kind of, you want it. And the flexibility to have various new offerings or services also. The other one is the market. So we have one big market competitor. It's from the past, but also we have these known big competitors. There are also some other smaller ones, but also the company that were our customer, like Amazon, are now bringing the parcels by their own to the customer. So they're changing from customer to logistic company, what's doing quite the same. So what we do or want, or what we got to know is that we are not that fast enough we want to be. So changes take a long time. Then data and quality access, something like master data is quite difficult, so they don't have one place for our master data, for our customer or for articles or whatever. Limited scalability, because we're not in the cloud with all of this stuff, so we can't rise it for the Christmas business. That flexible we want to do it. We have in many cases, as I mentioned, we have an AS400 for the production system, not that modern technology, with central business logic, so most of the business workload is done in this old system still today. And the level of automation is not that what we want to have. So, what do you want to do? 30 minutes to go. Around, depends on your questions. So what we first did is our survey. So we started perhaps 1 year ago with a new architecture team of 4 to 5 persons now, and we tried to find out what are the real requirements of our IT. So what we just did, we had 10 to 15 questions and sent around to the complete IT. So to get the answers. And this was from the management to the developer. And we got a really, really good response, not from all, but from a various response from very much people. And I brought you just three questions. And was sometimes surprising for us was the biggest or the most voted answer. So the first thing we asked, what do you think an architect could help for you? What is what you want from an architect? And it's not creating fancy whatever new strategy and all this modern stuff. But the first thing we want to have, document the current landscape, because we have no common, we have no holistic way. We have some documentation in Visio, so in PowerPoint, and whatever, but we need to have a current view we can address so that we have a starting point for new projects and we can address really that this is in good data. The other one is establish common IT glossary, that's also for applications. Then we have applications has name A, name B, so that we have a common language, not only for business and IT, but also on IT level. And the last one, of course, is create a target landscape where you want to go. But what you see is the current landscape is much more addressed in the questions. So then we ask, we look at the whole landscape, what are our biggest problems, what are the challenges today we have in there. Also, it's addressing the same questions. We are building, or we are good at Hermes in building new systems, but the old ones are still running. So it's getting not better, but it's getting more complex with new systems. We are doing a lot of parallel, and we have a lack of transparency about dependency. It's mainly about interfaces. So when I replace this system, what will happen? What do I have to do? What are the interfaces? So it has every project to do in the first weeks on its own, and does its documentation, does its projects, does the project finish it, and brings us to whatever file server, but it's not used for the next projects. And the last question, it also was interesting for us, when you have an EAM department, yes, the question is, are the teams autonomous, or is there any governance, or what do you want to have in kind of autonomy? So, isn't that you want clearly overall 100% autonomy for every team? And that we thought, for example, most of the developers would say, but they said, okay, because of problems or whatever they had, for core technologies, could be databases, integration, all these macro architecture topics, they said, okay, we would like to have some best practices we could address that you have a starting point and don't have to invent everything new. So to summarize it up, what we got as results from the survey, so we had to have a centralized and comprehensive documentation for the actual landscape. We had to build up a common vision, what has on a very high level for a better local decisions, because we don't want to say every team for every technology and coding what they would have to do. For that, we should or have to define macro and micro architecture. And what we also got because of changes that will be more and more in the future for prices and whatever will change in the logistic market, our team IT systems must become more transferable. So what we then did for this high-level target architecture, we created a picture. So what architectures do, creating pictures. And that is where we want to go. So we have the customer on the left side. There we are quite good still now. We have a lot of APIs for all the customers from various, depends on how big the customers, how deep the integration is. But the main part is in the first main part is in the middle that we want to have systems that focus on a data object or better on business capability. So what we today have, all these big systems mainly do 2, 3, or 4 of these capabilities. So we want to split them up and we want to give the teams an idea where you want to go, what are the capabilities, and when you create a new system, just go for billing or just go for check and trace or just go for order, don't mix it up. And the other part, what is quite important for us in the future, is the API or the integration of logistic partners. Because if you have perhaps heard in the press, there's a lot of pressure, a lot of parcels, and it's really hard to get the drivers and the physics to bring the parcels to the house door. So what we will have in the future more and more is a kind of integration with other logistics partners. Don't know what it will be like, but there will be cooperations of logistics partners in the future. So we have to be ready to get the data to have an integration so that we will build up in the next years. So we will have it. Okay. On that ideas, what was our EIM approach? So first big goal, what I said, is one place where all EA data can be found. And all all data is not that we have all of the data for all of the application with all details, but more a holistic view. So that you have to have the applications with the names, some information, and you want to go in detail, you go to a link to a wiki or whatever, or ask persons who is responsible, with a clear focus of collaboration, because we don't want to enter every data for every system, but that should be the product owner, solution owner, whatever, data architects. There should be a possibility to bring them to edit their own data. So what we furthermore want to do, to have a roadmap. So we are not good in closing applications, as I said. We want to have a transparent roadmap, what are new applications, when do they come, and when do old applications phase out or even are not more in business. And that's quite difficult, but we want to have a clear statement from the person that is of, that will really happen. And that we are the other requirements, what are therefore use also Confluence. We have some power users that are architects, solution owner, and some product manager. But we hold offers in the other users, managers, I want to know something about an application or whatever. So it should be a solution, or it should be a tool, or so tool support, where all these users can easily log in and update and see the data. So for the project, we have some context information for domains, so there's a holistic view, what I said, and an overview of the current landscape. So what then our evolution in development EIM? So 2-3 years ago, we had a lot of documents in the file server. That's Word for every documentation, PowerPoint, Visio. We also did this stuff on a project. We did a detailed documentation for all this, for some of these context diagrams and this stuff. So next, what we recognized perhaps 2 years ago, we said, okay, we need something where it's collaboration. So we had an wiki, we have a normal intranet, but we have also a wiki system with Confluence, and we added a so-called service catalog in the wiki, where they have the main of the applications and of the solutions with some of the fields. So we have this aspect of collaboration and transparency and easy to use. Now what we then found out, it is good for collaboration, but we want to do some roadmaps, some reportings, and we want to have some not really hard processes, but some easy processes. So we thought Confluence is quite a Confluence is a document, you can edit whatever you edit, and it's not really, you know, not have a process or a check or whatever in this tool, or it's hard to implement. But we then decided to have Linux for a clear structure and for a uniform language and a simple modeling of the data. So what we want to address with Linux now in the future is to even have more collaboration, to have an established tool with good and verified data. And at the end, wherever that will be, don't know, we have an EIM as normal daily norm. So when some of the employees could also be in the business, wants to know something about a business capability or a data object or application, we will don't think about it, just enter the Linux URL and get the information. So wherever we there will take 10 years. So then discuss a little bit more the integration part for the EIM. So we have a various tool landscape. It's not only Linux. We'd like to show you. So of course Linux is in the middle because in the Linux EA Connect days. But what we have at the bottom is mainly this IT operation stuff. So we have some BMC tools for discovery, for CMDB. We have Flexera for license management. So there are tools available that have data. So that needs to be synchronized. And on the left side, we have this IT department, strategic, finance. They have sometimes Jira, some of their, also they have some other tools, but they introduced, for example, Apptio, that's a software as a service solution for controlling. Then we have all this project level at the top, project management, requirement management. We of course have the developers. We have on the right the incident management, IT operations, and for example, CEOs who need some KPIs. So that's the tool landscape. So what we want to have in the first phase is one single point of truth for application. That sounds simple, but we had lists, PowerPoint, visuals, documents, and we had no common name of application and no common ID. So what we will try to do in the future and already did for some systems is an integration on application, and that is mainly ID, description, and responsible person. So what we're going to rid of is these extra documents with different data set. We have one single point of application. Like I said, it sounds simple, but when we have it, it's quite good to build up other integrations and other questions on top of it. So for sure, it's in the most of the integrations, it's not done automatically, but also done manually via Excel and all these other communication tools. But there is integration in place. So then we have three other topics. First, integration for developers. And of course, you know, developers are not don't like to enter data in enterprise architecture tools. So they have the developer stack and want to stay in the developer stack. So we have to have a solution where a developer can use their normal developer tools. So it, at our side is Jenkins for our deployments. So what we did is we used the standard integration of LinaX, the microservice add-on with requirements. It has to be automatically, could be added in the continuous deployment. There must be a seamless integration to developer stack, and this must be easy to use. So when you go to a developer, he needs to have 3 hours to get it working, he won't do it. So what we did, we used this in standard way, mainly for basic values, developer teams. We filter out only important libraries. Don't know if you have used the microservice add-on. In our case, when we get all of the libraries, we will have easily for one microservice 150. So if you have unlimited edition, you can do it, but there are a lot of libraries typically used in Java projects. So we just switched out via whitelist some of these. And what we get back is also links in LinaX to the source repository and to the build chain. So it was quite easy to adopt. We had some problems on our own for firewall and proxy and all this technical stuff, but then it ran perfect. So what we then did, what is our meta model, or what's our model for data in applications? So we have the normal applications on level one, just standard. Application have most of the attributes of the data, like subscription tags and business capabilities interfaces. But what we had in the past is something we call solution. So there was a question in the past, application is a bit more too technical, so we want to have something other for the conversation to the business department. So we introduced a name called solution, which is a logical aggregation of some application. So we kept that, don't have a hierarchy in Linux, but used tags for it. So for example, for our website, MyHermes, there are 5 to 7 applications and they're all grouped by tag. So we have these level one applications and microservices always on level two. So they're always automatically created via add-on. We don't import manually microservices. What you have to do is once to add the parent app or where it belongs to and the criticality and of course some informations you want to add to the microservice. So not every information will the developer give. So they have to have some manual update you want to do in your EA repository. And then you can use, it's also interesting, tags for some technical information. What library is used, what pattern, whatever, how important is. So the developer can write on his own some tags on it. So then we have this MyHermes, this application, and underneath we have in common 15 of these microservices. So to have the number, an update for the pipeline, what is done. This development part is quite nothing changes for the developer. Here's Maven Java, NPM for JavaScript. Here's a normal build file, the Maven build file, and it's just one file. I think you can nowadays generate from Linux directly. What we did, we built it on our own. So it's quite simple. I will show you an example afterwards. We will go to the Bitbucket, our version control, push the file to the CI server for manual or for automatic builds. We only get the information from the production builds, so we don't gather the information from the development or integration test or whatever test stage, but only from production. And that has been sent to the Linux via PVO integration. And what's kind of missing, was in the original slide from Linux, that this is posted to some communication tool, what could be in our case, Rocket Chat. So again, another view for automatic documentation. So we have the source code, the build, the Linux metadata, this is the PVO. You get the dependencies and put it automatically in step 3 to the Linux inventory. So it looks like this is a simple Java, a simple YAML file. There's some IDs. We have this unique ID. This will be a name in Linux. You have a type of the service. You have an owner. That's the email address. It's mainly a development team in our case. Description is gathered from the POM file. You have the entries for the version control and for the build chain. You have tags. You have life cycles. And at the last point, the whitelist of the libraries you want to have now at the moment in Linux. So that's, you can have a blacklist to don't have some libraries, and you can have a whitelist. So that's today. What we want to do is, okay, we have mainly 2 to 3 teams running with a microservice add-on. We want to have it to more teams. It's about 15 teams we have in the on the development side. We want to have more integration in the files. So, for example, 8 data objects to have directly links in the applications. We want to extend more use the versioning. And one question we always have was, where do we document deployments or release notes? So that could be an idea to also have it in Linux, perhaps as link or perhaps in any data object. And the other one is more integration. Rocket Chat, that is our Slack, our communication tool. And with the BMC, that's our hardware CMDB tools, to have more interaction there that they, for example, know this application and know these links. So, for the developers, then we have the process modeler, that's mainly the Signavio integration. And that's pretty much simple. Now we have Signavio on the left side and Linux on the right side. So you mainly get processes from Signavio, because Signavio is the master of the processes. But you fill the glossary of Signavio automatically. So you have all your IT systems, your data objects, business capability, data structures, all what you want to give to the process modeler. You will have automatically in the Signavio repository so that you have only one name for one application, and they have a direct link afterwards back. So it's for the enterprise architecture guys good, because you have only this one application, and also for the process modeler, they can just use the application and don't have to create it. So what our requirements was, an out-of-the-box integration, because I think to write that down is not that easy. Sync the metadata, and no extra efforts for the process modeler, so there should not be extra steps to get EA data, just use it. And the content I just said here. What was quite interesting, I don't know if one of you was at the Signavio BPM World 2 days ago, and also SAP had a talk there, and they're using also Signavio for their internal process modeling, and the internal process with a lot of licenses. And he always had in his slide and remark, we synchronize the data to an enterprise architecture tool, but he never said what was a tool. So somebody asked afterwards, what is your EA tool? And SAP is selling some of them, Power Design and this stuff. And he said, okay, we use Linux for internal SAP processing of the stuff. They also use a combination of Linux and Signavio, not their own tools. Quite interesting. So With our configuration is quite easy to do. What we get is the processes from Signavio. We use a top-down approach, so that you have the first the process levels also in Linux. What we do is process level 1 and 2 are business capabilities, and level 3 are the processes, and level 4 are sub-processes. So we get this level with also the relationship. You can add the parent process in the hierarchy, what you want to synchronize, because you have some projects perhaps in Signavio you don't want to have in your Linux repository. And the other part is down, where you synchronize user groups, application, data objects, and business capabilities. And they are always linked when they come back to the processes. So in Linux you can say, okay, this application has to be exchanged. Okay, there are four or five processes affected. Or data objects, also perhaps for the GDPR relevant information on these processes. So we will have very much interesting links. So we are just honestly starting a bit with Signavio, so there are only first experiences. We are just struggling out what the strict mode could be, so there are really no other IT systems in Signavio. We quite don't use it at the moment. We'll have some reporting, perhaps then the new Linux store could be the idea to have the number of IT systems per process or whatever criticality of data objects and processes or there's some nice requirements for reports. And we're just looking out if we can use a microservice perhaps in process. Make not sense in every case, but if we have a kind of 15-20 microservices in the process, the really cool thing would be to have what microservices addressed in the process. It's not really needed in every use case perfect, but could be a nice idea. So then we have this two integrations, but what we also find out, we have some users, some power users, but we have a lot of users. There's Linux just a new tool. They have 20 tools and Linux is tool number 21. So they are using some tools, this could be in an intranet, but what we mainly have is a wiki, what is Confluence. So also learning from other projects were, go to the tools where the user are. So they are using a wiki, then you give them some possibility to see the data or to see the entry of data there. So we also did that integration. As you know, in Linux before, we had a Confluence integration, not the one André said or pointed out today morning, but in the past it was a link of an image from report to Confluence, and we always said them, okay, we need to have data there that's up to date, and we have a list of applications grouped by whatever stuff, so there has to be real-life information in Confluence directly. So some months ago, they don't have a solution, so what we did, we just implemented on our own. So it's not that complicated. The main of the effort was to set up this Confluence development environment, but it's not that simple for us. And the Linux part was quite simple. You create a GraphQL, get the data, and put it to Confluence. So we had always up-to-date data. We don't need to have a separate login in the Confluence. That is mainly addressed on our side via single sign-on, via XAML. We want to have various diagrams with various levels. And what is clear, Confluence is for us at the moment, read-only information, and then you have to have a link and go to Linux and edit the data. So right now we have two main components, an overview table is the list of applications and a detail page. What I would like to show you now is an overview. We get gathered some informations. It's quite small, okay, we have someone's application, it is the quality seal, how many information is edited, the solution owner, business owner, the cost center and criticality. So there's information they had before, it's mainly an overview of the applications, and when you want to have more information, you just click on the link. So for the user in Confluence, it's quite simple. It's just a macro, select it, and the information is there. But the other one is the detail page, looks pretty much the same. We have the name of the application, the ID, we have the text on the top, the descriptions, and again, the most information, the most the most important information there. Also there is also a macro where we add the ID of the Linux application and it's displayed there. So what is there next? What we want to do? Okay, Andre was a bit faster than I with the talk, so we also had some conversation with him, and the second point is integrations of reports is similar like Signavio is doing it for the wiki integration. It's quite cool, and we will also use it because snapshot is not what we also found out is not sufficient, so we have this tough integration now. Also for custom reports, so we will also develop some reports like for our cloud roadmap and all this stuff we want to have for our occasional user directly in Linux. Okay, so far to the integration part. And there are two points left in the presentation. The one is cultural change, and perhaps you have read it in the internet. The Otto Group is doing a lot of in the cultural change, and also Hermes is investing there a lot of money to bring not only the IT but the whole organization from a hierarchy organization to a more agile or flexibility. And what we also thought with our users and our departments, it's a basic for all of the changes. So I don't know, said it Peter Drucker or whatever, culture is eating all. So we need to collaborate with users, with developers, with business departments, with project manager, and you have to have a culture, you have an openness where this communication is possible and successful. So what we also did, we have different expectations. Of course, you have different stakeholders from development to management, with specific requirements, reports, and all these ideas. And what we always did to find out any quick value. For example, we talked to the supporting guys who get all these messages and tickets when the systems are not running. And they need to know who is responsible, what are the dependencies, the data objects, description on what server is running. And they don't have it today. What they have is a 1 to 5 year old word paper you have to fill out when you bring a product in production. That is done by a product manager with a minimum effort. That is done, that is going in production, but then the data disappears and it's not actual. So we had a training with him, discussions, and they're using Linux to get more information when a system incident occurs. The other ones is breaking up silos, strengthen cooperation, building a common understanding, agility, and this transparency stuff. So it's basically what Katie also said, is a lot of discussion, communication, ideas exchange. That is the main job, and not telling it only once or twice and three times and four times to get an effort, because they have all these teams and all these managers have all their own problems, their own ideas, and they come, hey, we have a new AR tool, use it, it's cool. So we know you could use it for many solutions, but it's not obvious for them. So you have to have a lot of communications and conversations. So book for some good ideas, don't know if you know it, not that I get any money off it, but quite not that in 2012. There are a lot of agile ideas you can just not only use in your company one by one, but there are some really cool ideas you could just perhaps change a bit and try in your application. That's about lean and agile and enterprise 2.0. So the collaboration part and the agile part. So to sum it up, lessons learned. So what I did, especially for the part of integration, I googled a bit and saw there must be some other page or topic around integration and how important is integration for ERM. And I found an article, the link is on the bottom, and he said, okay, there are problems around architecture tools or even enterprise architecture that only a few companies integrate their ERM tools in other topics. So it's often a tool where it's also a data silo. There is some data in, but it's only in there, some guys. edit the data or read the data, some others not. So the other topic, business typically do not provide for exchanging data between ERM tool and BPM or CMDBs. That we mainly do with the Signavio integration, with the microservice add-on, and also with the BMC stack. So what's conclusion, another simple reason for a lack is almost all companies, CRM is an IT job, and it's also okay, and on the Hermes side, it's also addressed, as also the team is also in the IT. What we are doing, various formats, also in cultural change to address, to get more in contact with the business guys. So it's mainly, you must work together. So and what they said, to use the better potential, should define and implement consistent interface, enterprise-wide data model is on our side called business object data model. And this recommendation is to set an ERM tool as a central data source with integrated or with interfaces to other solutions. So there's a single point of truth. So it seems to be not that complicated, but start with this and have an one application list in Linux and go further with the other use cases afterward. So just a short review of our project challenges. We started around 1 year of 1 year ago with Linux. So what we wanted to do is simply make all users and have familiar with ER, with enterprise architecture, was in an easy way. We have various groups from development to managers to business, and it's exactly this collaboration part and this integration part in the existing tool landscape. So what we had then, we had an own data model before. We've now an intuitive, as an easy handling with a simply data model. We have specific views for specific questions, also these GDPR question, clear responsibilities, and at the bottom, this integration in microservices, in Signavio, and the CMDB. So it's really important part for us to have an integration working. And the other one, takeaways, perhaps, it's a new organization, a bit different, our creating social networks, cooperate with different people, just talk to each other. Perhaps you find a business department that has some specific questions you can help with some reports or some data views. Create a company-wide data model with a single point of truth and provide different levels of detailedness, also perhaps by reports or by aggregations or by different views. And if you can do it, use flexible and automated integration. Not for everything, there's no paradigm to integrate automatically every data set and every application. A good integration could also be exchanging an Excel list that you can manually upload. If it only changes twice a year or whatever, then you don't need, need to have an integration running. So what I found in the agenda some various other talks around integration and around agile. So it's just the talk of Thomas that was just before, but we have a deep dive expert level for the microservice and for Signavio and for also for the ServiceNow integration. And the other one is Osram with a lean approach and the standards and governance from Patrick. So to conclude it in one sentence, integrated ERM tool is possible. It's hard work, but you can do it. Thanks a lot.